Hello everyone, thank you for joining today. So my name is Kiva McOtter. I am the foreign professor at the TESOL Graduate School, and it's really nice to be here today. So our topic for today's colloquium is culturally responsive teaching. So as language teachers, this is really important because language and culture are intertwined. We can't have language without culture. And we are not just language teachers, we are educators. So it's really important to intertwine culture into our teaching. So that's what I'll be talking about today. Hello, Amanda, thank you for joining. Okay, so sometimes I will be asking you guys for your opinions and thoughts. So if you could please type into the chat bar when I do so, that would be great. Hello, Vanessa, thank you for joining. So I was just explaining that today I'll be talking about culturally responsive teaching, and you will find out exactly what that is in a little moment. So let's start with our PPT. Okay. So I'll be showing you a PPT today. I will be going through that, and as I said, at times I will be asking you for your ideas. And when I do so, please type into the chat bar, because unfortunately you are not actually able to physically talk to me. So I hope that you can all see the PPT right now. And I will be providing my email address at the end of the colloquium, so that if you have any questions, you can just contact me to ask. Okay, so first we need to discuss what is culture, because culture is the essence of culturally responsive teaching. So I know a few people have joined. Some of you may be in my culture and communication class at the graduate school. Hello, Catherine. So if you are in my culture and communication class, you should be experts on this. So I would like you to type into the chat bar, when you think of culture, what do you think the definition of culture is? So I would appreciate your ideas. So before I explain what culture is, I would like you to tell me what you think culture is. Hello, Jesse, thank you for joining. Thank you all for coming on a Saturday. I know that it is your day off, so I really appreciate you all joining today. Okay, so what is culture? That is my first question. So I would love if some of you could volunteer your answers in the chat bar. Take your time, because I know it can be a little bit clumsy typing into the chat bar in English, but what do you think culture is? So I'm curious to hear. People have different ideas and different images when they think of culture. So Amanda says life types. Okay, great. Does anyone have any other ideas? I think it takes a few seconds for me to see your answer. So Dark Choco, so Vanessa, culture is what we learn and share. Very good. Oh, Nura, shared behaviors and thoughts within a certain group of community. Awesome. Okay. So Vanessa says, including language itself. Amazing. Great answers. So I will share with you the way of life, says Juhi. Very good. Okay, and Jesse says, I think culture is not only about the language, but also the whole things that describe us. Very good. So culture is, a lot of people, when they think of culture, for example, Korean culture, they think of just the food, the music, but culture is so much more than that. Culture is a complex system of knowledge, values, traditions, beliefs, and relationships that gives meaning to and influences our lives and our actions. So culture influences us in so many ways that often we don't even realize. So it's not just the clothes we wear and what we eat, it also includes our implicit behaviors. So culture is shared between groups of people who have a common history, location, language, religion, or social class. So it's important to note that even when someone is from the same country as you, their culture might be slightly different. Because, for example, Koreans are of different social class, they may have different religions. So all of these things tie into culture. So as I said, culture is dynamic. Within cultural groups, we have variations amongst individuals. So that's going to be one of the focuses of today's colloquia. So recognizing the different individual characteristics that we have in a culture. So how is culture related to teaching? So again, if you have been studying the culture and communication class, you may have learned a little bit about this. If you are a teacher already, you're probably aware of this. So culture is central to learning. It not only plays a role in how we communicate and receive information, but it also shapes how we think, perceive, and act. So this means even when a group of students are all being taught using the same curriculum and material, their learning experiences are likely to be different depending on their culture and their cultural values. So we must acknowledge that just because a group of students are all from one country, it doesn't mean that they all have the same backgrounds and experiences. So even when I am teaching a group of students all from Korea, they have all had different experiences that all come into the classroom. So very, very important. So culturally responsive teaching is the topic of today's colloquialism. I keep saying colloquialism, sorry, it has a totally different meaning than colloquium. So although the concept of culturally responsive teaching, which we often abbreviate as CRT, was introduced in the 1990s, it has only recently become very popular. So what exactly is culturally responsive teaching? So culturally responsive teaching is an approach to instruction which attempts to make meaningful connections between what students learn and their cultures, languages, and life experiences. So it's used to create environments, curriculum, and teaching methods that recognize and value the richness of cultural knowledge and skills that students have and draw on these in order to make learning relevant to the students and also effective. So it's not just a single strategy or program. CRT is an approach that you weave into every aspect of your instruction. So you don't just make one culturally responsive class. This is something that you should be incorporating continually into your teaching. So what are the benefits of CRT? Why has it become so popular recently? So incorporating culturally responsive strategies into your classroom, first of all, it creates an environment in which students of all backgrounds feel safe, respected, and heard. This is really, really important because students succeed in environments in which they feel safe and comfortable. It strengthens the learner's sense of identity when you are bringing culture into the classroom. It helps students to feel both valued and empowered. It promotes equality and inclusivity, both inside and outside the classroom. So by bringing culture into your classroom, then it also kind of strengthens that equality and students' behavior outside of the classroom when they actually leave. It engages students in the course material, so it makes the learning more relevant to the students and more interesting to them. And it encourages critical thinking, so thinking about both sides of an argument. Finally, it builds cultural competence, which is a term I'll be explaining in more detail in a moment. So there are lots and lots of benefits of CRT, so it's really important to try to incorporate it into your classroom. And lastly, it bridges the gap between the teacher and the student. So it kind of removes that distance between the teacher and the student when you are making your class more culturally responsive. So how can we build a culturally responsive classroom? This is the focus of today's lecture. So I'm going to just give you an overview of the different strategies we'll be looking at. We'll be going into those in more detail with some examples, and I'll be encouraging you to give some ideas. So as educators, so I want to emphasize that we are educators, not just language teachers. We are educators who kind of have a responsibility to teach our students about culture, because so much of what students learn about life comes from the classroom. So the first way we can achieve this is by reflecting on ourselves, critically looking inside ourselves. And I'll be explaining that in more detail in a moment. Finding out about our students. So it's really important to find out about our students' cultures, our students' needs. And again, I'll be discussing that in more detail a little bit later. Adapting our curriculum, so the textbooks, the materials that we use. Rethinking our classroom decor and layout. So thinking about the bulletin boards in our classroom, the walls in our classroom, how we can use those to integrate culture. Introducing cultural activities. So I'll be going over some different activities that you can use in order to bring culture into your classroom. Managing our class effectively. So I'll be talking about dealing with behavior in the classroom in terms of culture. And highlighting similarities in cultures as well as differences. So often when we learn about cultures, we learn about how cultures are different from our own. But it's also really important to emphasize to your students that there are similarities between different cultures in order to help your learners relate more to people from other cultures and be more empathetic of other cultures. So let's get started on self-reflection. So this is the first step in building a culturally responsive classroom. So the first step in being culturally responsive is to do an internal audit. An audit is like an investigation. So when a company has an audit, someone comes in and investigates the company. So the first step when we want to be culturally responsive is to really look inside ourselves. So we need to take some time to ask ourselves hard questions and assess our past and current behavior, both as individuals and as teachers. So you might be thinking, what does this mean? So I'm going to give you some kind of food for thought. So I really like this quote. We seldom realize, for example, that our most private thoughts and emotions are not actually our own. For we think in terms of languages and images, which we didn't invent, but which were given to us by society. So sometimes unconsciously, the way we think is actually shaped by the society in which we live. And that translates into the way we behave and into our teaching. So it's important to recognize that our own culture determines our attitudes and our beliefs. These attitudes and beliefs often unconsciously affect how we relate to our students, select our curriculum, plan lessons, and assess achievement. So I want to emphasize the word unconsciously. So often without even realizing it, our culture is affecting how we treat others and how we deal with the classroom environment. So in order to build a culturally responsive classroom, the first step is to be aware of our actions and work to shift our mindset to one that is open-minded. So regardless of whether you are teaching a group of students from your country or whether you are teaching a group of students from a different country, it's really, really, really important to try to be open-minded with our class. So how can we self-reflect? So we can start by asking ourselves some important questions to determine our level of cultural competence. So what does cultural competence mean? This means our ability to understand and interact with people from various cultures. So the first thing we should do when we are self-reflecting is to try to really ask ourselves these important questions. So I've made a checklist of questions that you can ask yourself in order to determine how culturally competent you are. So the first question is, am I aware of my own bias and behavior? So often we are biased towards particular groups and maybe we actually don't even realize we are almost innocently biased. And so we need to think, am I aware of how I act? Am I aware of the bias that I may have towards certain groups of people? Am I ready to challenge any assumptions and stereotypes that I may hold? Am I willing to learn and accept how culture may impact the daily lives and activities of my students? So culture can often affect how students act in the classroom, how they conduct themselves, how they carry out their daily lives. So just one example is if I am teaching students from a different religion, for example, if I am teaching students who are Muslim, maybe they need to take time out of their day in order to pray. So that's one example of how culture may impact someone's daily lives. And we need to really kind of learn and accept that. Do I understand that cultural norms influence forms of communication? So I'll be talking a little bit about how cultural norms can influence communication later, but where we are from often influences the way we interact with others. So it's important to understand that different people interact and communicate in different ways. Do I make an effort to learn about other cultures? Am I able to identify when a student is behaving in a discriminatory way? And will I intervene? So this is one of the trickiest things as a teacher. So if you see a student who is acting kind of discriminatory or using bias or prejudice, first of all, are you able to identify when that is happening? And secondly, will you stay silent or will you choose to intervene and deal with that problem area? And are my teaching styles adaptable to students of different cultures? So if you answered yes to all of these, then you are extremely culturally competent. But these are difficult questions. And I always try to ask myself these questions every so often, because cultural competence is something that is very dynamic and it's always developing. So remember that cultural competence, as I said, is continually evolving. It's something that you continue to learn over your entire teaching career as you interact with people from different backgrounds and different experiences. So as educators, our beliefs and attitudes make a huge difference. Students perceive themselves through the eyes of their teachers. So remember that students spend so much of their lives in the classroom, and it's really important for us to have the right beliefs and attitudes. What teachers do and say impacts students' self-belief and their self-confidence. So one way that I mentioned that we can self-reflect is by doing this kind of cultural competence audit, asking ourselves these difficult questions. But there are also other ways to self-reflect and critically look at how we teach. So you can consider videoing some of your lessons and analyzing how you teach, asking yourself questions like, do I balance my time equally amongst my students, or do I tend to focus more on certain groups of students? So sometimes we don't even realize we are doing this. We need to kind of look at our teaching as an outsider in order to recognize whether it's something that we are doing. Are the comments I make about other groups and cultures biased or stereotypical in any way? So often we have these stereotypes and we don't even realize that we are kind of using them in our communication. So it's really important to reflect on what we say to our students as well. So another way to self-reflect is to try to understand your implicit bias. So implicit bias means the unconscious attitudes and stereotypes that affect your understanding, actions, and decisions. And you can take some online tests to discover if you have any implicit bias. So I'm going to link this website at the end. This is called Project Implicit, and it was created by Harvard. And on this website, you can use it. There are tests to check your bias about things like transgender individuals, disability, religion, skin color, race, nationalities. So you may not even realize that you have a small bias, but by doing these kind of tests, it allows you to reflect on that. And so it would be great if you guys would like to take some of those tests a little bit later after the class. I'll be sharing the link at the very end. So the website is called Project Implicit, but I know that there are various websites like this online that allow you to test based on your answers. It will tell you if you have a kind of subtle bias or a stronger bias towards or against particular groups of people. So by exploring how your own culture impacts your teaching practices, you can develop a mindset that strengthens your relationships with your students, including those from different backgrounds than your own. Okay, so the second part or the second strategy that I want to talk about in terms of culturally responsive teaching is to find out about your students. Find out about their cultures, their needs, their interests. So how can we do this? So finding out about your students' backgrounds, cultural values, expectations, attitudes, practices, interests, all of this is a great way to build relationships with your students. So it can also help guide your instruction. In order to meet the needs of our students, we need to know who they are. Really, really important. So you can collect this kind of information at the start of a semester, at the start of a year, by distributing questionnaires and surveys to gather information about your students. So when I teach a new group of students, this is one of the first things that I do. So I give them some kind of questionnaire to find out who they are, why they are learning, and kind of what their goals are. You can also have discussions with your students individually and as a class. And you can have conversations with other colleagues who have perhaps taught the students before or who know your students personally. So it's great to be proactive and find out about your students from the very beginning of the semester or the term. Once you have collected enough information, tell the class you will focus on adjusting your teaching approach in order to maximize their learning experience. So usually once I've gotten a lot of information from my students, I will say something like, okay, now that I've gotten to know you all a little, I plan to adjust my teaching so that you can all have a great learning experience. So it's all about adjusting your curriculum to meet your students' cultures and needs. So throughout the semester, you can also develop this by paying attention to the topics that your students are finding engaging, establishing set times to sit down with the student and give them an opportunity to speak about themselves in a more personal setting. So often at the beginning of the term, I will schedule small meetings for 5 or 10 minutes. And during those meetings, it's usually during lunchtime or break time. Hello, Yeonju. During those meetings, I will just take one of the students and we will talk about the student's culture, the student's background, the student's learning experiences. So usually at the beginning of the term, I will put up a schedule on the bulletin board and I will give the students a set time just to come to talk to me one-on-one. It's also a great idea to learn about highlights from your students' cultures, such as traditions, important historical figures, and behavioral norms. So when I first came to Korea, I had really tried to research a lot about the country, but it was quite overwhelming. And when I started teaching, my students would say things like, oh, teacher, you don't know Big Bang? And I was so embarrassed. But now that I've learned more, it really helps me foster a better relationship with the students by knowing more about their culture, how they think, what they enjoy in terms of Korean culture. Okay, so the next step, and a very important one, and I'm going to be getting a lot of your ideas here, is to adapt your curriculum. So adapt the materials you use in order to make them culturally relevant and inclusive. So how can we do this? Now that you've carried out your internal self-audit, the next thing to audit or reflect on is your curriculum. So think about what textbooks your students are using, what books are they reading, what media are you introducing into the classroom? So it's important to maintain an inclusive curriculum that provides a balance of world cultures and is respectful of differences. So I want to emphasize, especially when we are using older textbooks, you will often find that the pictures in the textbooks are of Western white people, particularly with American or British textbooks, and often the names are Western white names. So this isn't so problematic with the new textbooks, but there are still some issues which we'll be looking at in a moment. There can still be some subtle issues. So it's really important to critically assess your textbooks before you start to use them. So the first thing I want to talk about is stereotyping. So often we're so focused on complying to a textbook and teaching the textbook that we don't focus what is actually in the book. So critically evaluate the materials you use for your teaching. So what images do the students encounter? Can the students see themselves and their culture reflected in the textbooks that you are using? So watch out for materials that promote gender, racial, and cultural stereotypes. If you do see these in a textbook, address them, draw your students' attention to them. So studies show that children from the age of 5 start to form stereotypes, generalizations about groups of people. And a lot of that comes from the classroom. So often textbooks will build on these stereotypes. So it's really important to be critical, especially when you're looking at images in your textbooks. So let's have a look at a few examples. So here we have a textbook, which I guess is teaching about culture or nationalities. So this textbook, we have a photo and it says a Mexican and his hat. So I would like you guys to look at this photo. And can you tell me why this could be problematic or why you may want to draw attention to this with your students? Why might this promote some kind of stereotype? So if you can type in the YouTube search bar, I would love to hear your ideas. So if I see this in a textbook, I'll probably kind of draw my students' attention to it. Why do you think that I would do that? Why do you think that this could be problematic? A Mexican and his hat. So this hat is called a sombrero. So why do you think that this could be problematic? So I will wait for some responses, no pressure. Oh, thank you, Anne. So all Mexicans don't wear this hat. So if a child sees this picture, they probably get this image in their head. Oh, Mexicans wear big hats. So I know that in my culture and communication class, when we talked about stereotypes, a lot of you guys said that there is this stereotype that all Koreans are good at Taekwondo. So where do you think this comes from? A lot of it comes from textbooks. So maybe I open a textbook and there is a picture of a Korean person with a Taekwondo outfit on. Then as a child, I'm probably going to think, oh, Koreans all do Taekwondo, or Koreans are all good at Taekwondo. So it's really important to try to draw your students' attention to this. Not all Mexicans wear this sombrero, and usually it's only on special occasions. So this is an example of, I guess, like a nationality or country culture stereotype. What about this one? So maybe someone other than Anne. I think this textbook was in maybe an Eastern European country, I believe. And a lot of newspapers kind of featured this textbook as an example of stereotyping. So can anyone tell me what the issue is with this particular textbook? So I guess the topic of the textbook was probably something like jobs. So it shows a woman who is holding a baby and thinking about getting married. And it shows a boy who is studying and I guess thinking about himself becoming a doctor. So why could this be problematic? Does anyone have any ideas that they would like to share? So if you have any ideas, please type into the YouTube search bar. Anne, very good. That's a good one to point out. Very good. So it shows the woman thinking of herself getting married to a man. So this, yeah, definitely. Same-sex marriage is becoming more and more common. So this kind of promotes an image of, I guess, heterosexuality. Gender stereotypes of jobs, very good, Nura. And Catherine also says baby gender is boy. So I think the main thing here, one of the biggest problems here, is that it kind of promotes a patriarchal stereotype of the woman being kind of the having a baby, getting married, this is her dream, whereas the boy's dream is to become a doctor. So it kind of promotes a certain kind of old-fashioned gender stereotype. Very good. So thank you for your answers there. Okay, it's also important, as well as stereotyping, it's important to be aware of insulting depictions of diverse communities. So this means like hurtful images of different communities, different races, different genders, and so on. So let's look at the first one. So this one, I guess the definition is black, and it shows a picture of, I don't know how to describe this person, like quite primate, uncivilized, like someone not wearing any clothes, almost like a warrior. So this builds, I guess, if children look at this, it promotes a certain kind of stereotype of black people as being less civilized than, for example, Asian people or white people. So this is very problematic. Another one here that I found is, I guess this is some kind of vocabulary list. And the example word is trouble. And the example sentence is, Audrey got into trouble with her family when they found out she was seeing means dating, when they found out she was dating a black man. So if I read this as a child or a teenager, I'm probably going to think, oh my gosh, I can't date black men, I will get into trouble. So this again is kind of insulting, depicting towards black people. Another example, this one is widely talked about. This one, I think, was from a textbook in Hong Kong. And a lot of the curriculum has been criticized for their representation of different nationalities and races. So here we have, I am British, I am an English teacher. So you need to fill in the blanks with the country, the relevant country. The second one, I am Filipino. I am a domestic helper in Hong Kong. So domestic helper is like a cleaner. So I guess this builds an association between Filipino people and kind of lower income or manual labor jobs such as cleaning. Okay, I am Japanese, I have a sushi restaurant in Hong Kong. So again, this builds a kind of, I guess, insulting image towards Filipinos, because especially when children see this, they're going to be influenced and think, oh, Filipino people are usually cleaners or domestic helpers. So it's really, really, really important to have a look at the textbooks you are teaching, especially when they are older ones, and think critically about the kind of stereotypes and images they show to your students. Okay, so when reading, so another part of our curriculum, it's really important to provide diverse literature. This allows you to introduce your students to cultures, ideas, and traditions from all over the world instead of just the white Western world. So I remember when I was learning in school, all of my reading books were about white people with white names, and I didn't really learn about any other cultures from my books. I only saw white people. So it's really important to be critical of the reading material and books that you're giving to your students, as well as the textbooks. So by giving them diverse literature, it enables students to see themselves in what they're reading. And studies show that learners process content more effectively when their cultures have a place in the curriculum. So one example of a nice little reading book here, this one is called Same, Same, But Different. And we have, I guess, children from two different cultures. And the book is about different cultures, basically introducing children to different cultures. And this is a color vocabulary book. This one, all the photos of children in this book are children who have Down syndrome. So this is, we often do not see children with Down syndrome in our textbooks. So it's really nice to have these kind of materials where students can see all different kinds of children from different cultures, abilities, backgrounds, and so on. So I'm also going to link a useful website at the end of the class. And this one, I think, has about 30 different books that are all very diverse. and they are for different age groups. So this website is great because it groups the books into like the level and age group. So if you do want to introduce more culturally relevant and inclusive reading books into your classroom, I think that you will find that website really useful. So as well as our textbooks and reading, it's also really important to consider the media that we are bringing into our class. So when showing images, videos, or movies of other cultures, try to ensure they depict a range of cultures positively and avoid the risk of stereotyping. So I'm going to ask you guys a question. When you see this picture, please comment which city or country do you think you are looking at? So imagine I show you this picture in the classroom and I say, okay, what city is this? What would your answer be? So please type into the chat bar. I want to hear all of your responses. You can just type one word. What city or country do you think you are looking at right now? I'm really curious to hear your answers. It really looks like Busan, I think, but it is not. So Anne says San Francisco, USA. Okay. Yeah, the bridge. Okay, I see where you're getting that from. Okay, anyone else? Don't be shy. So Dubai, okay. So Yeonju says Dubai, okay, interesting. Would anyone else like to give their, okay, so Vanessa says China, okay. Any other ideas? Nobody has gotten it correct so far. So while I'm waiting, I'm going to show you another image. So Busan, so Anne says Busan. When I saw this picture, I thought maybe it was Busan. So I'll show you another image. When you look at this picture, which country or city do you think this one is? So everyone, please look at the second image. You will see some red. We call this like shanty town. Which country or city do you think this image is from? So Yeonju says India, okay. Jesse says India. Vanessa says India. Okay, I'll give you guys 10 more seconds to think about it. Catherine says India. Everybody is saying India. Bahrain. Okay, Nura. Sri Lanka says Catherine. Okay, I will tell you the answer. This city is Mumbai in India. This city is also Mumbai in India. They are the same city. So as a student, I see this one and I think, wow, India is very modern, very developed. If I see this image, you guys seem to be shocked. If I see this image, I'm maybe going to think, oh, India is dirty, India is poor. So unfortunately, the image that most students see of India is the second one. They don't see that India can also be very developed. So this is a big problem for when teachers introduce materials in relation to developing countries. So it kind of promotes this stereotype. So it's really important to show a balance when you are representing countries or cultures in your classroom. So another example is this one. So this is Rwanda. So if I show this image of Rwanda to my students, they are maybe going to think, oh, in Rwanda, children must carry water. All children must do this. They live in very small houses that are made of wood. And the children here aren't smiling. They look quite sad. If I show them this image of Rwanda, they're going to think, oh, people are well-dressed, they're happy, they seem to be in some kind of academic environment. Wow, Rwandan people have a good life. So these contrasting images show the importance of what you introduce to your students in the classroom. So just from one image, the students can have a totally different idea of what a country is like. So I'm not saying that you always show positive images, but try to show a balanced representation of a country or a culture when you are introducing it to your students. So I hope you learned a lot from that one. So when making your own materials, you can also include your students' names in readings and example sentences. So this helps to make the text more relatable. So especially when I'm teaching something like grammar, I make my own worksheets. So I use textbooks to help me, but instead of having names like Chris, Anne, I change them to my students' names because it makes it more relatable for the students and it also helps them to remember the grammar points more when they see themselves in the material that I'm using. Okay, so I've talked so far about self-reflecting and about learning about your students and adjusting your curriculum. It's also really important to think about your classroom decor, what you are putting on your walls in the classroom. So I remember when I was younger, my walls in the classroom that I learned in were filled with a lot of white figures, like people like Einstein or Marie Curie. Like I didn't really see images of people from different backgrounds than my own. So it's really important to think about what you're showing on your walls. So incorporate images of diversity on your walls and bulletin boards. This representation serves as an important reminder that everybody belongs in your classroom. So look at your classroom walls and ask yourself whether all of your students can find relatable visuals. You can even get your students involved and ask them to select posters of quotes and individuals who they relate to. So for example, children love superheroes. But when you look at superhero movies, usually the superhero is a white person. So Black Panther became very popular because the superhero was a black person. And that was he was the first person that black people could look up to as a hero in the American movie media. So with children, it's important to try to get them to find role models who are from their own culture and background, and they can select posters that they want to put on the wall or maybe important quotes as well. So you can also get your students to make some kind of wall decoration. So I really like this one where it's the students' hands and they have colored in the hands, maybe in their own little way. And there's a quote saying, share our similarities, celebrate our differences. So it kind of makes them acknowledge that differences are not something to be looked down on, but something to actually celebrate. This one is a bulletin board, thank you, Rosa Parks. So if you are not familiar, Rosa Parks was a famous activist in the Black Civil Rights Movement. She refused to give up her seat on a bus for a white person. So at that time, it was expected that black people would stand up and white people would sit down in the bus, but Rosa Parks refused to do so. So she is a big role model for a lot of, first of all, black people, and also for girls, because she is one of the big female role models for girls. So it's nice to create these kind of bulletin boards that contain role models from the student's own culture and from diverse cultures. And this one is also a nice little bulletin board where the students have kind of made pictures of themselves, and there's also a quote related to diversity. So by having this in your classroom, it really immerses the students in a culturally positive environment. So another great resource is World Maps. So you can build on your map throughout the semester or the year and encourage students to add information about different countries and different cultures as they start to learn more and more. So you can see an example here. You can use this in any subject classroom. And here we have a map of the world and there are little arrows pointing in different information about different countries. So this is a great way for all age levels of students to kind of add information about what they are learning about different countries and cultures. So now I'm going to talk a little bit about introducing cultural activities into your classroom. So a great way to make your classroom more culturally responsive is by introducing activities that first of all give your students a voice to talk about their culture and also give the students an opportunity to learn about other cultures. So first example is you can assign students research projects that focus on issues or concepts that apply to their own community or cultural group. You can watch and discuss documentaries. So this is better for older level learners, or sorry, higher level learners and adults. But you can also find some simple documentaries on YouTube that are made for younger learners and that introduce different cultures and concepts to them. You can use problem-based learning scenarios where students must solve real-world problems applying their cultural perspectives. Assign journal prompts where students write about themselves, their families, their cultures, their traditions. So you can do this in English class or Korean class as a little writing activity, and it gives students an outlet to talk about their own cultures. Conduct a show and tell where students share items and artifacts, cultural objects from their home. And you can also allow students to bring in their own reading material and present it to the class. So this kind of empowers students. So usually a teacher will give the students reading material, but you can ask the students to actually bring in some kind of article or some kind of reading that they feel they enjoy reading and that maybe introduces some part of their culture or their belief, and they can then do a presentation to the class. Okay, so I have a couple more strategies that I want to get through. The next one is managing your class effectively. So this is really, really, really important. So what does this mean? Teachers build caring, cooperative environments when they educate students on how to treat one another with respect and immediately confront any biased or discriminatory behavior in the classroom or in the school. So it's essential to make your classroom a judgment-free zone from day one, from the very beginning. So you can encourage your learners to ask questions when they wish to further their understanding. Make critical thinking the norm. So a lot of students are scared or worried or nervous about asking questions. They feel embarrassed. But by encouraging your students to do so and giving them a comfortable environment, it enables them to ask questions and you can educate them to develop their understanding. Welcome discussions about current events or behavior. So it's important to allow your students to talk about important things that are happening in the world culturally or politically, but be sure to emphasize that conversations should be directed toward learning, not criticizing. Very, very, very important. And teach your students to value each other's differences. So reflect on how your classroom management techniques suit different learners. So if you have been studying culture and communication, you will have learned a lot about how different cultures have different ways of thinking, different behavior. So when you are establishing rules and dealing with problematic students, it's really important to think about the different learners and different cultures in your classroom. So when deciding how to approach a student's misbehavior, consider first of all, whether the behavior could be due to a cultural clash or some kind of miscommunication. And also think about whether the rule itself is perhaps inappropriate in some way to the learner's culture or the learner's beliefs. So explain to the student why a certain behavior is unacceptable, but also ask why he or she did it, in order to better understand how the student perceives classroom rules and relationships with other students. So I'll give you an example to make it a little bit more concrete. So in the past, I have taught learners from Brazil. If you have been to Brazil, you will know that time is not very important or strict. Brazilians are very relaxed. So often, my Brazilian students would just maybe not come to class or turn in their homework late. And at the beginning, I would get angry and say, the rules of the class are you must submit your homework on time. But by learning about their culture, I started to realize, okay, this is something cultural. This is like kind of a clash between Western culture, where time is important and where we stick to deadlines, and Brazilian culture, where it's a little bit more relaxed. So in that situation, it's important to try to think about where your student's behavior is coming from. Is it something cultural? And then try to address it and come to some kind of agreement with your student. And remember that sometimes culture is harder to see, but it's still very significant. So for example, some students might come from cultures where time and deadlines are not so strict. So I gave the example of Brazilian culture. This is very common in kind of Latin American culture where time is a little bit more relaxed. Other students may come from collectivist cultures where the focus is on the group as opposed to the individual. So in Korea, the culture is very collectivist as opposed to in the West where it's more individual. So you should think about those things when you are teaching your students. So think about the culture they are from and what kind of beliefs and behavior are common in that culture. So try to keep these more subtle parts of culture in mind when considering structuring your lessons and managing students. And my final tip is to highlight similarities. So often when discussing or teaching culture, the outcome can be to focus on the differences. So often when teachers have a class about culture, so for example, different festivals around the world, or different ways of celebrating New Year, then the teacher will emphasize, oh, this culture is very different. How is this culture different from ours? But it's really important to also draw similarities and connections between one culture and another. This encourages your students to relate more to cultures other than their own. So it kind of stops that divide, oh, this culture is very different from mine, and it helps the students to connect cultures and individuals together. So how can we do this? How can we highlight the similarities between cultures? So one way in which we can do this is by forming a discussion about a student's community or culture and looking at connections with other cultures. So for example, I can put a discussion question on the board, who are the people who help in your community? So possible answers, my students will probably say things like nurses, doctors, police officers, firefighters, teachers, ambulance drivers. These are people who help in Korean community. And I can show images of these people in countries around the world and ask my students, okay, so how are they similar? And maybe my students will say, oh, they wear the same uniform. Oh, they have the same equipment. So try to build similarities instead of focusing on the differences. Another example discussion question, which special occasions do you celebrate? So maybe my students will say things like birthdays, New Year's celebrations. So you can discuss why these are universal celebrations around the world. Why do all people celebrate these things? Another example question would be maybe, what are the qualities of a friend? Your students will probably say things like, friends are kind, friends talk to me when I have problems, and ask your students, okay, what about in other cultures? What are the qualities of friends? And your students will think, oh, it's the same qualities that we have. So it's really important to try to build those connections so that your students start to relate to other cultures instead of thinking that they are very different and unapproachable. Okay, so I want to end with just, education is the greatest equalizer. This is something I strongly believe. So education is the thing that can really create equality amongst individuals and groups of people. So use your role wisely. It is so, so, so important to use your role as a teacher, not just to teach language or to teach a subject, but to kind of influence the way your students think and get your students to be open-minded and respectful of others. So I'm just going to end with a couple of websites that I mentioned before. The first one is Harvard Implicit Bias Tests. So I showed a screenshot of this website. So this is a great website to use if you are not sure if you are biased towards particular groups of people. I am not judging in any way because I've actually done these tests and realized that I had bias. I didn't even realize I had. So I think this is a really useful resource to find out kind of how your culture affects your bias and it's something that you can then reflect on. Another website I mentioned was this one, Diverse Book Choices for All Grade Levels. These days, especially with, for example, the Black Lives Matter movement in the US and around the world, there are a lot of websites like this popping up that will give a lot of reading resources that you can use with your students that represent different cultures instead of just Western culture. So there are books on this website where the students can read in English, but they're reading about children in Vietnam, children in Korea, children, immigrant children from China in America, African children, all different cultures of children. So I really, really recommend this website. And it's great, as I said, because it gives you recommendations for all different grade levels. And this is my email address. So if you have any questions about the lecture today, please feel free to email me and I will be happy to answer any questions you may have. So we have a couple of minutes left. If you guys would like to ask any questions, I will do my best to answer them in the time that we have. Or if you would like to leave any comments about today's class, please do so. So you are free to do so now in the chat bar. Thank you all for your participation. It was great that you all contributed and typed things in. So does anyone have any quick questions or any comments that you would like to make before we finish up? I'm not sure if everyone has been very quiet or if there's just a time lag. Maybe not. Okay. Well, if you do have any questions at all, please make sure that you email me. The spelling of my name is very difficult, so be careful when you are typing it into your email address toolbar. We will end the class here. And thank you so much for your participation. And I hope that you have a great weekend and stay healthy and warm. Thank you, Rose. Thank you, Vanessa. I'm glad that you found it interesting. Have a great weekend, everyone. Bye-bye.